It's incredibly important at this time to free ourselves from the identification with things in the plural. And we do this by choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and that gives rise to the overlay effect of unconditional love, and we identify with that. And that is one thing, not many. It's simply one thing that's unchanging, that can't be changed in any way. That will protect us. We identify with that. We see our identity in that instead of the external world. If we see our identity in the external world now, we're going to suffer horribly. We're going to be traumatized because the external world is going to go through a massive series of changes, like a dominoes falling very soon. And if our identity is resting on all of that, we're going to feel as if our identity is being traumatized. And even though this is just a dream, it's a make-believe, imaginary, hypothetical, plausible scenario and not reality at all, if we identify with it, we believe in it, we're going to suffer terribly, be traumatized. Now, take everything back to the beginning of existence to see how, what our situation really is. So we're spirit. We chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator instead of spirit. And that's an impossibility. As soon as we chose an impossibility, we had to believe in it, believe it was possible. And so then a belief system arose, the belief that it was possible. In actual reality and truth, it's impossible. So all we can do is simply believe that it's possible. And the belief that it's possible to become prime creator automatically it means that there has to be a means to do this, a way to do it. So we believe it's possible, and we believe that there is a way to accomplish this. So we have all our faith, trust, and belief that it is possible. And that is what this adamant belief, that's a fait accompli, that's a certainty that it will take place, that we will succeed in what we're doing here in this effort. This interferes, this causes us to halt. Okay, and keep identifying with what's taking place in existence, which is just loss. It's loss. We give the universe to ourselves so that we can then take it away from ourselves, as it were. Everything we give to ourselves is only for the purpose that then we can then subsequently take it away, suffer the loss of it. And this is being done to manufacture a power of loss that can be then turned onto reality and threaten the prime creator with the loss of reality unless the prime creator changes reality for us. That is the entire scenario that we're involved with. Now, we cannot change this scenario, but we can choose a different scenario. Okay, the scenario that we have chosen, that arises from the idea that we chose, has to arise from it. And we'll always, as long as we hold on to this idea of wanting to be prime creator, the scenario must arise this way. The scenario of loss, getting only so that we then lose. Can't change it. You can never change it. It will always be that way. Idea and its effects are unified forever. So it seems like, oh, there's no escape. Yes, there is. Simply choose a different scenario. Choose a different idea. And that's how you escape from the effects of the present idea. That's how it's done. And it's imperative that we do it soon because of the trauma that is coming up. That is why these videos are being made, why I keep on making them, doing my best to try and warn people about the urgency of the times. The times are, the remedy is always the same, always will be. Now, in the past, in the future, always. Choose a different idea, choose a new idea, choose a different scenario. Scenario of not trying to be prime creator. Choose that, and that will give this overlay of unconditional love, one thing overlaying everything equally distributed, everywhere, arising everywhere, exactly the same. And the entire universe is overlaid simultaneously in the same amount, everything equal. Nothing to change. You don't need to go anywhere to experience it differently. It's exactly the same everywhere in the entire universe. You will feel this perfect peace everywhere you go. You're in the center of it because there is no, it's exactly the same everywhere. So the center is everywhere. Okay, so you're never out of sync with it. It's impossible to be out of sync with it. This is very doable to choose this. And it's simply, what I've found is that there's this belief system that we have that is so completely assured that we're going to succeed in building this power of loss to threaten the prime creator, and we're going to be prime creator. It's totally assured, has total belief in this. And you run into that belief, and there is this period of very uncomfortable situation, because it's confusing. It's very confusing because there is no reasoning taking place whatsoever. There's merely the presence of this adamant belief that there's going to be success. This whole endeavor will be successful, and no, not a shred of doubt, just total belief. And you know that this is a false belief. It's belief. It's simply belief in accomplishing the impossible. You know that, and yet the unwavering refusal to even consider that it's not possible is somewhat unnerving and uncomfortable. Uncomfortable. So it's not easy to choose a new idea because you run into your own belief, your own adamant belief that seems so powerful and so adamant and is not willing to in the slightest bit consider that it could be wrong, could be mistaken. So it is not easy. It is uncomfortable. There's a feeling of discomfort and disconnect there as you go towards choosing a new idea, but it is doable, and we will do it. Otherwise, we'll suffer tremendous trauma, or at least the experiencing will be very traumatic, will be interpreted as extremely traumatic to our identity, what we believe we are. And so we are truly under the gun right now to make that simple choice. Let's choose a different scenario, that's all. Very simple choice. And the stakes are extremely high, so I keep pushing this, keep pushing, even though at times it's very difficult, very difficult. Last night I did have a dream where I encountered the very root of this belief that it's possible, and it was very, very uncomfortable situation. I was confused, very confusing. Even though you're doing the right thing, I did the right thing, I still felt like a little bit confused because here's this belief and someone personifying this belief that has not the slightest clue what you're doing or why you're doing it. And they're totally sure that what they're doing is the right thing to do, even though it's completely wrong, completely mistaken, completely insane. So complete insanity is a very confusing thing to come across because there's no way to have any sort of sane interchange at all. So I just, did the right thing, took the right actions, and somehow reestablished the proper situation. But the belief system just had no connection, no insight whatsoever into what I was doing or why was I doing it or nothing like that. So it was just like, wow, very uncomfortable. But I got through it. It's like eating a ghost pepper, and you get through it. You get through it. At some point, it becomes very uncomfortable, and you say, "Uh-oh, I don't know if I can get through that." But you get through it, and once you get through it, you say, "Ah, okay, wasn't impossible. I got through it. Not a problem." So I'm trying to break the ice on this choosing a different idea, choosing a new idea, choosing a new causal agent, choosing a new scenario, so that you do not, none of us get traumatized by the changes that are to come. There are changes on every level of energy. Energy spins out all these levels, okay? And it can bring change to all those levels. Rapid change, slow change, all different types of change. And that is what is coming upon the world right now, is tremendous amount of change. and not the kind of change that we would welcome, the kind of change that we would say, oh my gosh, you know, the world is being torn down, you know, that we're losing everything, it's terrible. That's the kind of change that is traumatic. It's by design. It's purposeful. That's what the purpose of existence is, to inflict trauma, to inflict loss, and to try to develop the capacity to inflict such devastating trauma and loss, that's, and then transmutate that, catalyze it into some real power that can inflict this loss on reality. And we're just testing out, we're using these bodies and all this energy to test out this power and to develop it. So we keep experimenting and testing like we're like laboratory rats, and we keep being tested and see, you know, how bad is the trauma? Is it traumatic enough now that we can apply it to reality? And we keep testing it that way. So we're like guinea pigs, really, like guinea pigs. And we don't have to. We don't have to keep on with that guinea pig situation. We can choose a different scenario, choose a different idea, choose a different causal agent. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality. And that will free us from this trauma. Free us from identifying with things, external things. We'll only identify with this unconditional love. We'll see, ah, that is what I really want. That is what reminds me of my identity. So we will temporarily identify with that, and then that will be eventually be easily translated into fully accepting our true identity in reality. So we need to continue on looking at this choice and what is hanging us up. And again, I had this incredible dream last night where I was able to face this implacable entity, as it were, but that embodied this whole belief system of existence. And I saw that it was just a dead end, a complete dead end. And I went about and changed it, made the change. And from that point, there was a very, very fullness, very positive situation that came about from that. And yet it was this very, very awkward, uncomfortable, confusing situation. So that is there, you know. We don't do it because deep down we kind of know it's kind of unpleasant for us. It's worrisome for us. And it's like eating a ghost pepper, which I did on Labor Day. And, you know, I didn't want to really do it. I was afraid. And then you do it and you think, oh, boy, I don't know. And then you keep eating and you think, this is going to be unpleasant. This is going to be difficult. Yeah, it is. But it is doable. It is unpleasant to meet up with that belief system, the root of that belief system, which simply has not a clue as to what you're doing. Not a clue. And thinks you're just completely insane. You know, there's nothing wrong, and for sure this is all gonna work, and everything's just working perfectly, and just has this focus that is, you know, completely crazy. And you have to decide, no, you're gonna make a change, even though that you're getting no reinforcement whatsoever from this belief system. None. None, zero. So it's what I would describe the feeling as uncomfortable and confusing. I felt a state of confusion. Yeah, it hit me. But I was still able to carry out what needed to be done and did a very good job at it. But so it means it's capable, we're capable of doing it. But there is, you feel kind of like woozy from this confusion, like, uh-oh, am I really doing the right thing? And you get some doubt, throw some doubt and confusion into you. If there's this belief system that just completely dismisses what you're trying to do and completely believes in it, in that it can accomplish, the goals of existence can be accomplished, completely believes in that. Wow. So, but the good news is, it's doable. I got through it. So that gives me confidence to realize, yeah, we can do it. It's not impassable at all. It's not impassable, which is why I emphasize getting conviction, clarity and conviction through contemplation will enable you to withstand that period of confusion where you sort of start doubting like what you're doing is right, fixing this situation, choosing a new idea. You think that, sort of feel like, well, I'm not sure, because this belief system is completely dismissing and ignoring, you know, the efforts to choose a new idea. It's totally uninvolved in it, cannot resonate with it at all, sees no reason whatsoever to do that, and just getting past that. I guess that's called in the dweller on the threshold. The dweller on the threshold, getting past that belief system. This is a term that's actually was introduced by Joao Kuhl in Theosophy. And I don't entirely, you know, I don't entirely reject all that. I have a different emphasis. But, you know, there could be a lot of, there could be something to what is said, I don't know. Some things seem to be useful. If you see something as useful somewhere, you can use it. Dweller on the threshold is a useful term, actually, to apply to what I experienced last night. It was like a dweller on the threshold, no question about it. And it was like this implacable belief that nothing needed to be done, that no change needs to be made, no choice needs to be made. It tries to paralyze your action of choice, of choosing to a new idea. It tries to just paralyze it. Invalidated entirely. I have to change this a little bit. It's just an invalidating presence, this belief. So it is like a dweller on the threshold that is in your way, and you have to walk past that dweller on the threshold. And you know, I experienced it very, very vividly, very clearly last night. The night of the, the 6th of September 2012. So, if you don't have enough conviction, you're going to get all nervous, for sure. And then you're going to try and please this belief system. You're going to try and please this dweller on the threshold to try and make them agree with what you're doing. You want some agreement. You say, hey, I'm changing a terrible situation. I'm choosing a new idea. I'm helping you out. You know, I'm freeing you. And you know, so don't you, you know, aren't you happy about this? And if they give not a slightest indication that they have any awareness of what you're doing, that is unnerving. You know, and then the confusion arises, and you want to get rid of that confusion by trying to placate them. But what I saw was that was useless. And I kept on fixing things and changing the situation, so it was not a dead end. And there was a proper situation. Just kept on doing it. And I didn't try to converse or convince or anything with this belief system that was personified as an entity there, actually. So as we come down to the point where we really need to do this, and we're pushing forward, we're going to be up against this dweller on the threshold. Let's use that term and thank Joao Kuhl for the term. I've not always been on the best of terms with Joao Kuhl because I just don't agree with the emphasis. You know, maybe at a certain time, you know, that was just right. I felt a need to go faster. I kind of felt like, you know, it's just don't need all that stuff, really. Come on, let's just choose a new idea. That's all we have to do. We don't have to go through all these initiations and all this stuff. We just need to choose a new idea. And that's true. That's all we need to do. That is it. There's nothing else we need to do. Choosing a new idea gives rise to unconditional love. We identify with that. we abide in that, as Ramana Maharshi said, abide in that, in the self, which is this overlay of unconditional love. That's all we need to do. That's it. And that's something that we can do, absolutely can do. And this dweller on the threshold is the final obstacle, which is what I experienced last night. I was wondering, I had worked through all these different fears, and I was very clear about it. I said, those are all bogus. And then I got this experience, which is different. It's not a fear, a specific fear. It is simply the totality of the belief system of insanity, the attempt to be prime creator, the belief that it's possible, the belief that the impossible can be accomplished. It was the very essence of that belief system, simply implacable, just staring at me implacably and unmovingly. And I saw that this situation, like it's a dead end. It was death, and yet this being just sat there implacably without the slightest awareness or urge to choose a new idea. None. You see, there was no awareness whatsoever that of the necessity to choose a new idea. So you're faced with this implacability. Now someone's here. And that is the final obstacle. It's not a specific fear, it is simply complete implacability. And so we do want to avoid that. There's no question. Just like I wanted to avoid eating that ghost pepper. I wanted to do it, but it's metaphoric. It's metaphoric. I have some video of that, actually. It's metaphoric because you don't want to do it, but you feel, you know what, I need to get past this kind of thing. It's like an obstacle. So the dweller on the threshold is the final obstacle. Past that, you choose a new idea, and you have unconditional love, and you are free from identifying with things. You're free of trauma. You're literally free of trauma at that point. So, but you have to go through this seeming trauma of the dweller on the threshold to get entirely free of trauma. And so we have to do it. So I'm talking about it. It's being shared here. This is very important. How did I eat that ghost pepper? By practicing other peppers, hot peppers, that weren't as hot first. Practicing. Every night eating habanero sauce on my food. So I got used to real hot peppers, hotter and hotter and hotter. And I finally thought, well, you know, I probably can eat this ghost pepper. And I did, and it was blazing, blazing hot. Okay, but then it peaked, plateaued, hit the plateau, and then you realize, it's not going to get any worse. I can make it through, and then you make it through, and everything's fine afterwards. Same thing with the dweller on the threshold. There's no way to remove all of the awkwardness of the situation, of coming across that which is implacable, sitting there presiding over a dead end and death and the belief in death and loss, and with zero interest in changing it, none, no awareness of what you're doing at all. And just this complete implacability, it is unnerving. It is uncomfortable and confusing and unnerving. All of that, you know, and it works on you. And what I found was it didn't cause me to go into any panic or anything. I still had a very clear head, and I just still able to focus on fixing. I had this job of connecting some hoses that were disconnected or some, causing a complete flow instead of a disconnection, a separation, a disconnection. I reconnected everything, got the right piping and the right flow, and then all the energy, so to speak, was flowing properly, came in, and it was metaphorically. There was a whole scenario of great success after that. And a great reserve, tremendous reserves of life that was established, Whereas this entity, body, the belief system that we have been believing in, you know, was just, oh gosh. It was like a skeleton all dressed up beautifully in jewelry and makeup, but it was really like a skeleton sitting there. With you know, flesh stretched over it, but the flesh was all, you know, it was like this aged corpse, a mummy almost, but dressed up beautifully, with all dripping with jewelry, and believing itself to be, you know, the most beautiful goddess imaginable, sitting there, but really it was just like it was a corpse. You know, it was the very embodiment of the idea of negation, loss, and death. It's like a living corpse. And yet, all ornamented and bejeweled to appear to be attractive, but with no awareness of the importance of choosing a different idea. Wow. So everybody is faced with a situation. That's why it's important for those who are facing up to this to share this fact with people, and so they can say, ah, okay. Yeah, there is something that is a bit nerve-wracking there. Yeah, that's true. There is. And yet, you say, okay, it's not impassable. It is not impassable. It is not. Unpleasant? Yes. Unpleasant? Yes. For sure it's unpleasant. And I don't. There isn't any way to make it entirely pleasant. No way. No way. But there are ways to get past it. And clarity and conviction, the work you do on contemplation, clarification, and conviction will enable you to maintain your integrity and your sense of purpose to choose a new idea. It will enable that to take place. That's what I experienced. I didn't fail, did not fail at all. Where a being is there who doesn't even recognize the possibility of being able to choose a new idea. There's no recognition. Zero. It's tough to deal with zero. It's confusing to deal with zero. You're not used to dealing with it at all. I just had to ignore it, you know, basically. Just ignore it and continue on, which is not easy because it seems like there's this being there. There's some super important being, and you need somehow to relate to it. There's no possibility of relating to the dweller on the threshold. It was like an old lady there, but dressed up to try to appear to be young. It was like a very wizened old lady with like maybe a wig on, you know, yellow dress, blonde wig, and made up and trying to appear to be, you know, the height of beautiful youth, beautiful goddess, and yet you could tell it was this totally ancient, decrepit corpse, you know. Wow. With all the kind of things it dressed up to make you look, you know, attractive and beautiful and powerful and authoritative, like the Queen of Queens, like that. It was an attempt to give that impression. That here was the very seat of all beauty and all goodness and all authority. And yet, at her feet, there was a complete disconnection. Total disconnection. And I just said, hey, you know, I've got to reconnect this. Meaning, I've got to reconnect with reality. In other words, I've got to remember reality. I have to return to remembrance. And yet, she was presiding over this disconnect of trying to forget, separate from reality, to forget reality, to develop this power to destroy reality. So there is this. I never thought of this, really. I never really understood dweller on the threshold. What does that mean? Well, now I know. There really is this. You will really come across this dweller on the threshold. And maybe sometimes in dreams you've come across it and gotten freaked out. Yeah, it can be a freak out, for sure. I mean, the potential for freak out was there, very much there. And I realized, I said, uh-oh, you know, This is not an easy situation. The air of confusion, you know, just a generalized confusion. It throws you into a state of confusion. It really does. It really does. But then again, got through it. That means this teaching of contemplation and clarification, what you get through that is sufficient to get past the dweller on the threshold. It is sufficient. You can prepare. You can prepare properly. And I've been wondering, what is all this preparation good for? And now I know, is to get past that dweller on the threshold. That implacable, that which doesn't recognize you at all, that which has no recognition of what your purpose is at all. A mummy, you know, all dressed up. A mommy as a mummy. Pretty strong stuff. But I could see the disconnect. I said, hey, you know, look, there's this disconnect here, and you're not even doing anything about it. You know, you refuse to recognize it. You've got no motivation to change it, do anything about it. I said, I'm going to fix this. I'm going to make a change. I'm going to choose a different idea. And they didn't, no reaction at all. Just implacable. Complete lack of comprehension. Total lack of comprehension. That's confusing, right? If you say something to someone and there's a total lack of comprehension, that is, there's a confusion arises. You think, whoa, why, you know, why is there this lack of communication? You know, what's going on here? Am I maybe not communicating properly or something? There is that. So that's what everyone has to look forward to. And it's either that or just be traumatized by this belief system, which is presided over by this mummy, this dressed up corpse, really. And if you try to get out of it and choose a new idea, that you will run it, you will come across at this point, this personification of the belief system. Yeah, well, this belief system will appear to you in such a way as to try and, you know, paralyze you and confuse you and deflect you from your purpose to choose a new idea. Now, I'm thinking, could I do it again? Yeah, sure, just like I could eat another ghost pepper. Do I want to do it again? No. Because it's very unpleasant. It's always unpleasant to meet up with total lack of comprehension in this way. You know, that is just something that we cannot, you know, deal with. It's nerve-wracking. So there is hope for us. There's huge hope for us. Gigantic hope for us. We have the capability to build up enough conviction and clarity through our self-inquiry, our contemplation, that we're literally able to get past this dweller on the threshold. We actually have that capacity. So there's tremendous good news here. Tremendous good news. And coming just in time, because those who cannot get past this dweller on the threshold have no choice but to succumb to the purpose, continue on with this purpose. And as I have said, I saw this, what I call the goddess of destructivity, personification of destructivity, is in the world and is at play, setting up this massive changes of energy, calling them transformations of energy. Energy, again, is simply imaginary. It's not real. So the energy symbols can be transformed. There's going to be massive transformations take place here. And if we're identifying with energy, with things, we will be traumatized severely. And so, you know, at least I'm doing my part in warning, putting the warning out. You know, some will listen, some will not listen. Some will not take it seriously. There are some questions to be answered. Those who have gotten past the dweller on the threshold and chosen a new idea, how much help can they be for others who are still afraid and are too afraid to do it? I don't know. Don't know the answer to that question. Something that is to be determined. But at the very least, getting past that dweller on the threshold does show it can be done. And that is a tremendous benefit. Tremendous benefit. It may result in many people saying, wait a minute, you know, I'm not going to quite go down that road. You know, maybe I'm going to slow down on that road. Maybe I'm going to turn to contemplation and say, wait a minute. I need to, before I go all in on this, I'm going to contemplate and check out, this is what I really want. All that's possible. But as far as getting past that dweller on the threshold, I would say you have to be prepared. You have to be prepared. No doubt about it. Which is why I emphasize preparation, preparation, preparation. Work, 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 work. Contemplate, contemplate. Keep on clarifying and gaining conviction about the big picture, that there's simply one choice between this option or that option. The choice between believing that the effects of an idea can be changed and to serve some other purpose, or that the effects of an idea cannot be changed to serve a different purpose, that what you have to do is change the idea. That's the difference. That's the whole thing that we're all considering. Which is true? Which is true? Which is true? That's it. Do we try and work to change effects? Or are we to try and work to change the idea? Changing the idea. Because by choosing a new idea, that will have new effects. That will have effects that are aligned with that purpose of what the idea is. The purpose of the idea. The effects will align with that perfectly. So we'll get free of the effects, the previous effects that we didn't like, we didn't really want. That's how we get free of them. Or what we're believing, have been believing, is that the way we get free is to change the effects. Keep the idea, but change the effects. That will never work. That's what doesn't work. So we're evaluating, you know, which is true, which is true. And hoping that we can change the effects, because we really don't want to face that dweller on the threshold. We're nervous about it, for sure. For sure, we're nervous about it. No question. It's good to just acknowledge it. Can't help but be nervous about it. It's kind of like some, you know, ultimate test. Like you're walking past, you know, this horrible, terrible mummy corpse that just, you know, freaks everybody out, and you have to walk past it and stay focused and do what you need to do. Can you do that or not? Or will you like just completely freak out and run back down the hall and leave undone, you know, what needs to be done? That's the ultimate test there. But it's just have to pass that test. No two ways about it. And if we see the test can be passed, and then we think, oh, great, we just need to do enough clarification, that's all. You know, you simply get down to business then. You get down to work. If you see something can be done, you get down to work and you work at it. Yeah, but there isn't any way that you can sugarcoat the situation. No way. It just simply boils down to conviction. If you know what you're doing is right, you have the power, the authority, and the right to choose a new scenario, to choose something that is not based on death, not based on trying to accomplish the impossible, not based on trying to separate from reality, disconnect, forget reality, all that stuff. You say, no, I don't want that. That's not what I really want. I'm going to choose to remember reality, to remember my home, to be delighted in reality, all the delight, the freedom, the safety, the invulnerability. I'm going to choose all that. You have the right to do that. You absolutely do. And this personification is going to try and, just by its complete disconnect from you, try to convince you that you can't possibly be right. You must be wrong. You must be doing something wrong. It will act in that way. And your conviction has to carry you through that. Carry you through. And I wasn't aware ahead of time that this was going to take place, really. Maybe at some deep level there was some nervousness or anxiety or fatigue and all this stuff. But I wasn't, you know, aware that I would have this dream. It happened. Boom. So I guess it's when you're ready, you know, you make the move. You make the move past this dweller. You go to where the disconnect is. What I did was I traced the disconnect. And I came to the end of the disconnect, and I said, aha, here's where it's disconnected. And then I looked up, and there was this entity there just, you know, staring at me, or just right there, right in front of me. It's like, whoo, wow, who's this? What is this? And, you know, I don't recall saying anything. I said, well, I found the disconnect, so I'm going to, you know, reconnect, as it were, okay? And get the proper connection going here. And this being just didn't, you know, just remained implacable the entire time. Ancient cultures used this dweller on the threshold theme to scare people away from buried treasure, hidden treasure in caves and various things. They'd have some statue was made up in a certain way that would trigger this response in those, you know, and it would freak people out. So as we're going to the treasure of reconnecting with the treasure that is our inheritance, that is reality, there is this, you know, implacable dweller on the threshold that is going to try and freak you out entirely and to drop what you're doing and not accomplish it. So this is a great step forward now in explanation. I was trying to find out how come I'm not finishing, because I've looked at all the different fears. I realized none of those fears are valid. None of them are justified. I should be able to then easily choose a new idea. But then now I see that there is this final obstacle there. And in seeing that, yeah, that's helpful, very helpful. It's like the personification, embodiment of all obstacles, the very essence of obstacles, of complete disbelief in that you have any capability to choose a new idea. Complete adamant belief that the impossible can be accomplished and will be accomplished. You know, all this stuff is just all condensed down into just a complete non-acknowledgement of you, complete non-acknowledgement. Zero acknowledgement. Zero acknowledgement. That's what it is. And today you feel fine. Don't feel anything unusual at all, having gone through that. So, the benefits of working on the spiritual path of contemplation, clarification, and building your conviction up. The benefits are that you're able to get past that dweller on the threshold. That is the benefit. And without getting past that, you're just going to stay right in harm's way. You're going to experience the trauma of continual change in energy, continual transformation of energy, nonstop. Always, whatever you get gets taken away from you. Always. Just a continual getting and losing, getting and losing, getting and losing, getting and losing. That's all that existence is, getting and losing. You will continue to experience that. And that's, you know, it's boring. It's no fun. It's traumatic. It's frightening. It's not what you really want. So you have every right to do the contemplation, do the clarification, build your conviction to the point where you can get past even the dweller on the threshold, get past that final obstacle. You have every right to do that, and every motivation to do it also, especially now. And we're like dressing up trauma. The world is dressing up all this trauma in jewelry. You make it seem, you know, beautiful. It's like constructing a mirage over an abyss so that we're attracted to this mirage, and then poof, we all go over into the abyss, you know, of trauma. I'm trying to call to mind that entity, but I don't really want to. So here we're heading into now the home stretch of the build up to the trauma. We're heading into the home stretch now. And there is a sense of urgency. I've said before in other videos, there was a time when I was intensely focused on A Course in Miracles, when I had a lot of interaction with Jesus during sleep. And basically, the interaction consisted of Jesus saying, go faster, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Come on, don't waste any time, don't waste any time. And just pushing this urgency, that's all it really was. There was nothing, you know, there wasn't anything, you know, profound, you know. All it was urgency. Go faster, don't waste your time. Come on, you can do better. It was like a coach, kind of like a workout coach, you know. Do more, do more, do more. You know, you do 50 push-ups, they say, come on, come on, you can do 10 more. Are you running? Say, come on, you're slow, go faster. And I say, I'm going as fast as I can. No, you can go faster. It's like that, really. That's what I experienced. There was no philosophical, esoteric discussions or anything like that. It was just saying, hey, you need to hurry up. There's problems coming. You need to hurry up. Look at this trauma coming. You need to hurry up. Hurry up, forget about this stuff, you know. Just get it done. Get it done. That's it. I wish I could report there was, you know, walks in these flowery gardens and, you know, all this wonderful spiritually romantic stuff. No, there was none of that. Just saying, look at the future. Look at what's coming. And hey, you don't really want that, so you've got to hurry up and choose a new idea. You got to get to it. Stop babying yourself, you know. Stop taking it slow. And I say, yeah, but other people are taking it slow. And you say, forget about all the others, you know. I say, well, what about these other people, you know, who are taking A Course in Miracles, and they're not, you know, they seem to be, you know, publishing books and doing all this stuff. Why shouldn't I do that? No, come on, hurry up, forget about all that stuff. Don't pay any attention to it. Yeah, but what about writing this? No. go. That's it, really. That's what the teachers ideally do, is they just say, hey, stop fooling around, get after it. And you say, how am I doing? Say, what do you mean, how am I doing? Go faster. if you ask them for, you know, a report, you know, they just say, what do you mean a report? Why waste time on a report? You got work to do. Get it done. And there's a reason for that. Because this energy, the changing of energy, the transformation, all this changing, all this loss, we've been given all this stuff and now it's going to be taken away. All these things, we're given all these things will be taken away. And if we don't choose a new idea, don't get past that dweller on the threshold, we will feel as if we're losing ourselves, that what we are, we're losing it, what we are. And then we'll shake in fear and say, oh my gosh, there is some power over reality, which will then just hook us in to the situation even worse. And we'll go through another cycle of all of this. And it's futile. It's futile. Just suffering, more suffering. Get hooked into more trauma. The more you believe in trauma, the more hooked in you get into it. So it's super important to at least hear this option, this other scenario of choosing a new idea, a new scenario. That the power of choice is the true power, and that there are obstacles on this path that you have to overcome. We all do. And it can be done. You can do it. Everyone can do it. Because you can. The power, the voice of reason, divine reason, will show you and help you look at the situation and see that it's all bogus. It's our belief that we can accomplish impossible is just a belief. Has no validity to it whatsoever. None. Zero. And you can build this up, clarity up, to the point where you can get past this belief system and set it down and move on from that with a new belief system, a new idea. The belief system that reality can't be changed. That's what we will exchange. We have the belief system right now that reality can be changed. We'll pick up the belief system that reality can't be changed. We have the belief system that we can construct a power over reality. We'll pick up the belief system that we cannot construct a power over reality. Okay? It's an exchange of belief systems that we're aiming towards. And of course, as you set one down, you take a last look at it and go, oof, you know, wow, what a terrible belief system. Wow, what a frightening belief system that is. And then you pick up the new belief system and then things go very positively. I experienced a tremendous positive buildup once I got past that dweller on the threshold. Something to look forward to. We think that maybe all these problems, changes can be averted. No, they cannot. It's coming in from different levels of energy. It's not just that we can, you know, elect the right person, make the right changes, laws, all that kind of stuff. No, that's not going to have anything to do with it. It's all something that is in energy. There is a fait accompli in energy. Things can be planned out and they will happen. See, symbols can, belief system and symbols can make things happen in the dream, absolutely. But that has nothing to do with making anything happen to reality, you see. It doesn't therefore follow from loss, you know, making loss happen in a dream. It doesn't therefore follow that means that the loss can take place in the dreamer. It doesn't follow at all. I mean, we believe that it can follow. Somehow. I cannot. Never will. So these times are tremendous times, actually. The urgency, those who meet the urgency of the moment will not regret it. Those who realize that the massive loss that is coming, the massive planetary sacrifice, the purpose of that is to test out trauma and see how effective trauma has become, that you don't have to go through that. The realization can come now. You don't have to go through that at all. You can sidestep it by choosing a different idea. And just when times seem the worst, that is when we will decide, okay, I've got to do it. I've got to make this choice now. Otherwise, we delay. Otherwise, we would delay. Who wants to meet up with that dweller on the threshold? Nobody does. Nobody does. And yet, the option is so terrible. The alternative is so terrible that we decide finally we just don't want to delay anymore. We're just going to have to do it. That's like eating that ghost pepper. I thought, why do I have to do this today? You know, why not tomorrow? Tomorrow seems like a better day. It was amazing all the thoughts that was going through my mind and how they're very apropos to facing the dweller on the threshold. Same thing. Say, no, I know I got to do it, but today just doesn't seem like the right day. You know, I probably will feel more like doing it tomorrow. I'll probably be better at it tomorrow. Let me wait till tomorrow. And I ate part of it, and I said, that's enough, that's enough. And then I said, yeah, now you know, if you've gone this far, why wait till tomorrow to eat a whole one? Just go, come on, keep going through. I was able to finally do it, but it's like that. We say, let's wait till tomorrow, but if we know how bad tomorrow will be, we won't have this belief that somehow tomorrow we're going to feel better. We're not. Nobody's going to feel better in this world tomorrow. We're going to feel worse. We're going to feel everything that we've identified with slipping through our fingers. And actually, that process has been going on for some time now. Everybody has been experiencing loss at some level, some of it very profound. The loss of freedom, the loss of certain lots of liberties, loss of feeling being able to speak your mind without being trampled by the PC police, the loss of feeling that you know you're judged by who you truly are in spirit rather than what your perceptions are in this world, you know, the loss of so many things that has already happened over the last 50 years here on this planet, really, it's just been a catastrophic loss already. But as bad as that's been, that's only the tip of the iceberg. Only the tip of the iceberg. The rest of the iceberg, we're going to hit it very soon. We are the Titanic, and we're going to hit that iceberg very soon. It's the 100-year anniversary of the Titanic hitting that iceberg. And when that iceberg is hit, you know, that's when the severe, intense trauma takes place, where the loss is accelerated. And at that point, you'll say, oh my gosh, you know, I wish I hadn't have taken this voyage. And you're also going to say, well, where are the lifeboats? Where are the lifeboats? So it's good to test out the lifeboats. You know, it's good to find out, where are the lifeboats? You're on imagine yourself on the Titanic, and everybody's dancing and gambling and engaged in this, in wild behavior, you know, drinking, eating, smoking, and just everything, you know, this wild party. And you excuse yourself from the party, and you go wandering out on the deck, and you ask yourself, what am I doing out here? I know there's some reason I'm supposed to be out here. I don't know what it is. You walk along the deck, and then you see, what is that? And you say, huh, what is that? And you lift up the cover and say, those are lifeboats. And you say, wow, interesting. And you say, how are these lifeboats held up? You know, how are they released? You know, how big is the lifeboat? And you start examining the lifeboat. Are there any provisions in the lifeboat? And then something tells you, like, hey, why don't I stash some provisions in this lifeboat? You know, and then you become acquainted with the lifeboat and the whole situation of the lifeboats, and you're aware of it. And then when it hits the iceberg, you say, ah, I know where the lifeboats are. I know how to lower the lifeboats. I have provisions in the lifeboats. And you just go with it. It's, sure, it's traumatic, but you get through it. You get through it. And those who have not done that, they panic and they just think, like, wow, maybe we better keep dancing faster and that'll solve the problem. Turn the music up. Play a little louder. As the Titanic is sinking, the orchestras, you know, trumpeters, you know, they're playing louder. And everybody's dancing faster, drinking more. And they think that's what'll cure the problem. But the ones who have intuitively felt, hey, I feel there's some danger up ahead, they are in the lifeboats. And the lifeboat is to choose a new idea. The lifeboat is to get past that dweller on the threshold, choose a new idea, and experience the infinite richness of choosing a new idea. Goodbye scarcity. Goodbye scarcity. Goodbye vulnerability. Goodbye fear. Goodbye to all of that. And, you know, you can't always get other people in the lifeboat because they see their safety as staying with the ship. And so you can't force people in the lifeboat. It's not possible. At some point, you have to get in the lifeboat before the ship sinks. Otherwise, it'll pull you down. You got to get free of the ship as it sinks. It can pull whatever's close to it, pull it down in the slipstream, as it were, into the water. So you have to be free and clear of the boat before it sinks, and you can't wait forever. And either people get on the lifeboat or they don't. There's a certain, you know, cutoff point, really. Because when the trauma starts happening, you start if you feel you're being traumatized, you're going to react to it. You're going to react, and you're going to react in some manner of denial, anger, feel fighting, you want to fight back, you want to feel sorry for yourself, all sorts of things. Some defense mechanisms will kick in automatically. Just like eating that ghost pepper, the endorphins kicked in automatically. I didn't have to do anything, they just kicked in. The defenses will kick in when you feel you're being traumatized. So you have to get in the lifeboat ahead of time. I mean, don't wait too long, as it were. And when stuff starts to unravel, you know, drop the lifeboat. Choose a new idea. Choose a different scenario. Make that choice. And again, we are afraid to make that choice because now I see there's that dweller on the threshold. It freaks us out. It can really freak us out. The implacability of it. The disconnect. Total disconnect. The zero awareness of what's going on and the need to fix, reconnect. All of that just unnerves us. It's as if you, in going to the lifeboats, suddenly there's this zombie stand, you know, this zombie in front of you, and staring, you know, right through you with complete incomprehension, and you know, he like startles you, like, whoa. Then you say, well, I need to go around this zombie, you know, and others will just be frozen in fear and then run away. But if you expect it and say, okay, here's this zombie of the apocalypse, this complete incomprehension, and okay, that's all it is. It's just this belief system that I generated by choosing the idea of wanting to be prime creator, this belief that the impossible can be accomplished, will be accomplished, for sure will be accomplished, and not comprehending any possibility that can't be accomplished. Zero comprehension. Now we're in a state of incomprehensibility there. You say, okay, that's what it is. Now just go around it. It is what it is. And you say, this is what I'm leaving behind. Great. Great, great, great. And you won't be intimidated by it. Just say, finally, I'm leaving this horrible scenario behind. That's what we have to look forward to. And why not succeed? You see, why not succeed? Why be traumatized? Because being traumatized won't help at all. Won't help you in the slightest bit. Will not help anything. It's just a waste of time. Total waste of time. So continue on with whatever your contemplation is. Continue on full blast and don't give up hope. You know, I was in a point where I was thinking, wow, maybe nothing's going to happen. This is terrible. I didn't realize what the final obstacle was. Didn't realize it. So that's why I was thinking. I said, I can't find any other obstacles to do work on, and yet I'm still, you know, stuck. What's going on? And I didn't realize, hey, there is this final obstacle. So just because you haven't succeeded yet doesn't mean you won't. It's just that you need to build up your clarity and conviction to a high enough level, high enough point, where you're able to face this implacable foe down and just get the job done. Do your reconnect in spite of this implacable foe refusing to acknowledge your existence, you know, at all. If you're refusing to acknowledge what you're doing, your purpose, nothing. Path is doable. It really is. And it is tough. Yeah. It is tough. It's important to recognize that this difficulty. Otherwise, we'll give up. We'll think we're not fit for it because we haven't succeeded. If you don't succeed, you must think, you know, wow, I'm not capable. I mean, I was really feeling that way. I said, maybe I'm just not meant to succeed. Because I've done everything I can possibly do and still haven't succeeded. So there must be something wrong that can get to you, you know, can get to you. But you cannot succumb to that. I didn't succumb to it, but, it was there for sure. I just said, well, you know, okay, that's there now. This is, you know, it's aggravating, disappointing, disheartening, dispiriting. But, okay, I just recognize it. Okay, let's see how this unfolds. Let's keep going. Let's keep making right effort, and we'll see what happens. But it does arise. It does arise, this feeling like you just don't have what it takes. Because the fear of getting past that dweller on the threshold is so intense. The uneasiness of going that far, uneasiness. Yeah, nobody wants to really do it. Nobody really wants to eat that ghost pepper. You see it on YouTube. Nah, you know, even the seasoned guys, you know, the guys and the gals that are really seasoned, they do it all the time, you know. When they hold a super hot, they're looking at it, and you can tell they don't really want to do it. They don't. And the ones who are really seasoned just say, you know, there's no way I can get past this unease, so I'm just going to not just do it immediately. Don't even think about it. It doesn't help their suffering any, but there is this feeling of uneasiness. Like, I really don't. I'm really in for it this time. I don't really want to do this. It's like that. There is this feeling of a very uneasiness. I don't want to do it. So if you just acknowledge that, yeah, I don't want to do it, but I really want to do it, but I don't want to do it. See. I really want to get past that dweller on the threshold, but I don't want to do it. You have to realize that there's a level of not wanting to do it. And then there's a higher level of saying, I really want to do it. I know it's not going to be pleasant, but I really want to pay that price. I'm willing to pay that price. That's how you have to look at it. So don't get knocked out by just this feeling like you don't want to do it. Don't get knocked out by that. That's normal. That's normal. So I really don't want to listen anymore. I really don't want to contemplate. I really don't want to try anymore. That's normal. That is to be expected, because there is this dweller on the threshold and there's no way that you can make it a pleasant experience. No way. Just like that ghost pepper, I knew it was going to be hot, super hot. There's no way I can make it not super hot. There's no way. You just have to steel yourself for it. Really have to steel yourself and just say, you have this determination, like, okay, it's this is it. I'm going to go for it, and I'm going to do it, and I'm going to succeed. That's it. And you have to have a lot of determination. A lot. You have to see the alternative is intolerable. And therein lies why I emphasize so much how terrible existence is, because it really is terrible. And there's no way you can make it not terrible. If you see existence the way that it really is, you'll have the motivation to get past that dweller on the threshold. You'll have the motivation. But if you keep sugarcoating it and say, oh, you know, everything I experience in existence is attracted to me by my own desire and thoughts, and I can attract really pleasant things and happy things, happy experiences. If you sugarcoat it this way, you won't have the motivation to get past the dweller at all. Because again, everything that you get in existence, you only get it so that you can lose it, so it can be taken away from you. Whatever happiness, whatever pleasant experiences you have, those will be taken away from you. So this whole notion of, you know, the power of attraction. I can attract, you know, a nice home, a nice spouse, a nice lifestyle, and happiness, and all this great stuff. It will all be taken away from you. So what good is that? It's not any good at all. The unvarnished truth about existence is it is, we are all born to die. It is a massacre, and is merciless. That is the real truth about existence. It is the attempt to generate a trauma so severe that it can actually then traumatize existence. And we are simply the guinea pigs. We're using ourselves as guinea pigs. We are spirit using ourselves as guinea pigs, traumatizing ourselves, trying to build up a trauma that's so severe that we see, oh, this can destroy us, and therefore can destroy reality. So we just keep traumatizing ourselves, and it never is sufficient. So it's just this endless trauma that we put ourselves through, endlessly. That's what existence really is. You see that, and then you say, wow, I'm going to face this dweller on the threshold, and I'm going to get past this, because the alternative is just horrible, which is why I'm, you know, adamant not to sugarcoat existence. Adamant about that. It is, because it's an excuse to say, why should I face the dweller on the threshold if I can attract, you know, a money and a nice car and good friends and, you know, all this stuff? Well, you know, why should I do it? You know, even the people with the most money and the most success end up getting Alzheimer's, right? Be bedridden, you know, go through the slow decline of Alzheimer's, you know, terrible afflictions later in life. They go through all sorts of severe trauma. They can have billions of dollars and the best money, medicine and doctors and money can buy, all the best friends, the best spouses, the best, you know, homes everywhere, everything. And they can go through this horrible, horrible decline. That is, you know, they get everything taken away from them, even their memories, all their memories of, they may be very accomplished, like President Reagan, for instance, all the accomplishments, lost any remembrance of any of that, lost it all. Just think about that. You can be the most powerful, famous person in the world, and you're going to lose your remembrance of any accomplishment you ever had, of any friends you ever had, of any family you ever had. You completely lose all of that, and then everything slips through your fingers. That is existence. That's the purpose of existence. Whatever you get will be taken away from you. So, with that in mind, keep that in mind. You then have the conviction that you got to keep working at getting past this dweller on the threshold, this embodiment, this personification of this insane belief system that has zero belief that there's anything other than this belief system, but that zero belief that this belief system cannot achieve success. You know, just stonewalling, complete stonewalling. You say, I have to get past it. I have to get past it. And it's, you know, so it's useless to pursue happiness in this world. It's useless. Whatever you get will be taken away from you. Don't pursue happiness in this world. Pursue choosing a new idea. Pursue clarity and recognition that this is absolutely essential. You cannot change the effects of an idea. It's impossible. No matter how plausible we believe it is, it's just still impossible. Reality cannot be changed in any way. And reality is all that there is. There is anything else other than reality. Even though we can have a dream of being able to change it. Only reality is. And that's it. All isness is reality, and there isn't anything other than isness. And yet we have the power to believe there's something other than it. But this belief has no isness to it. It's a fantasy, it's a hypothetical. Well, it does still have isness. It is a hypothetical. But it's not what we really want. We can see it's a hypothetical. The hypothetical is that there's going to be a transformation, and that's not true. So this dream is a dream. The hypothetical is a hypothetical. It will always be exactly what it is, a dream, a hypothetical. That's what it is. But the belief is that it will become something, it will be transformed into something different, and that is not true. That is not true. So it is a lie. It is a false belief. That's what it is. So there is isness to all of it. Yet the belief system dismisses this isness entirely. It says, no, it will change. It will change. We have hope that it will change. And there you go with hope and change. But it doesn't. Only more trauma. Only more trauma. This is like the Bataan Death March. Only more trauma. You know? The march doesn't get any better. It gets worse and worse and worse because we are desperately trying to finish off this trauma, constructing this power of trauma, power of death, power of negation, power of loss over reality. We're desperate to finish it off, so we want some grand catalytic ending to it. And so we're willing to throw everything into the bonfire, willing to discharge all our ammunition, you know, everything. All in, all our chips on the table. That's where we're at right now. We're willing to put all our chips on the table. Everybody, everything all in. Let's have a big fire, everything. Total conflagration. Time. We're willing to do that. We're willing to go towards that. We're willing to inflict all sorts of trauma on ourselves at this time. Every type of thing. You name it, from starvation to plague to, you know, sicknesses and illnesses and wounds and of every single type of situation, of trauma. We're willing to inflict it upon ourselves, and we're willing to have everything just be burned up in the end, some grand finale. It's like a fireworks show, you know. We're willing to shoot all our fireworks off now, and at the end there's just a tremendous finale, you know. That's what's going to happen with this world. And we're willing to do it because we think it's going to catalyze this hypothetical into a real. It's going to catalyze it, transform it, into reality. That this power of negation will become real and effective and active, like a viral agent against reality that can infect reality and destroy it. And then we can then bargain, bring God, Prime Creator, to the bargaining table, force the Prime Creator to the bargaining table, and then say, okay, what we want is that you must change reality and make us Prime Creators. You have to do that, otherwise we're going to destroy all of reality, and you'll have nothing left for you. You'll be annihilated. Of course, not realizing it will be annihilated too, but we don't believe that, because we say, no, we've got this new power, and we're the new Prime Creators, and we can create a new reality, so we don't have to worry about that. So this grand finale is coming up. This whole massive fireworks display show is about ready to begin. We're all around the lake, you know, and the buzz is building, buzz building. I remember when I was young, I went to Lake Geneva in Switzerland, and the Fête de Genève is this massive fireworks display. It's incredible. There's a parade, there's a huge build-up to it, and the atmosphere was unbelievable. It's incredible. The expectation was just, it was amazing. And then the fireworks finally started, and people were just, whoa, just, you know, it was incredible. And they went on and on and on and on and on. Then a tremendous finale, you know, it was all over the lake. It was stupendous, stupendous, the Fête de Genève. And before it started, you know, there was this buildup of expectation, and you could feel it. You could feel the atmosphere was, you cut it with a knife. We're in that right now. We're in this intense buildup in the world as the pyrotechnics of trauma are about ready to be fired off. And that's why we're feeling this, you know, feeling we're feeling. Wow. You know, we're almost there. We're almost there. And of course, there are many who feel that this, all this trauma, etc., all this change is going to result in some great transmutation of us, where we'll find eternal happiness after this. But that is a presumption that it's going to be successful in transforming a hypothetical into a real, and we'll be able to force God to the bargaining table, and we'll become prime creator. It's all based on that belief, which is a false belief. It's all based on that expectation. That's a false expectation. That will not happen. So all we're, but going into this with that expectation will seem to carry many through the trauma, like, oh, hey, this is great, you know. It's like a widow in past times in India going to the funeral pyre of her husband, it's called Seti, and believing that by going into the flames and being burned alive with the dead husband, that she will then, they'll both be together in paradise afterwards. And so she's able to walk into the flames and sit there, you know, in this prayerful way. And everyone says, oh my gosh, how spiritually advanced she is. Look at that, it's incredible. Because she has this belief, a super strong belief. So there's many that are viewing the future with a super strong belief that it's not trauma, really, if not traumatic, if it's successful. See, that is the mantra of the times. It's not really traumatic if it turns out to be successful and we're positive it will be successful. So it's not going to be traumatic for us. It's like, you know, like masochists saying, you know, they're willing to suffer all this trauma because they believe it's, in the end it's going to pay off for them, incredibly great payoff. So to them, they don't see it as a traumatic. But when the payoff doesn't come, then how, you know, then that's a whole different ballgame, isn't it? There's some point where they say, uh-oh, you know, uh-oh, it's not working. And then the trauma comes on strong at that point, which is what happens. You eat the ghost pepper and you say, oh, this isn't so bad. You know, say, oh, that's not bad at all. There's a little bit of heat and say, wow, I lucked out. And then there's a little bit of heat and you say, ah, okay, it's a little hot, but it's not bad. And it gets a little more heat, and you say, okay, this is hot, but it's not as bad as I expected. And then suddenly, kaboom. And you say, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. And it becomes a conflagration. Like there's a blowtorch, you know, like someone's applying a blowtorch to your system. It's incredible. That's what happens. You go through this trauma and you say, well, it's not so bad. Okay, it's pretty bad. Okay, this is pretty awful, but I know the transmutation is coming very soon. And when it doesn't come, then you say, oh my gosh, what have I done? What have I gotten into? And then the freak out begins. So I'm warning, I'm saying, hey, you know, don't even go down that road at all. Don't go down that road. You cannot... Nothing real can be transformed. And whatever can be transformed is not real. And if it's not real, it's an attempt to establish a power over reality. Okay? And the only way to do that is to threaten Time Creator with the destruction of reality. And the only way to work on this threat is to build up loss and trauma. We have to believe in trauma, that we can traumatize the reality. Traumatize the prime creator. We have a way to traumatize it and destroy it. And so we're using ourselves as guinea pigs. That's the only thing we can do. We can't apply it to reality of the prime creator now, because nothing affects reality of the prime creator. But we can believe that we can affect ourselves. Symbolically, with belief, we are literally, we think and believe we are traumatizing spirit. What we are. We're not. We're traumatizing a belief, an image, a belief in what we are. Okay. We're not traumatizing what we really are, but we're traumatizing a belief in what we are. And so it seems very real, seems terrible, horrible, and we will just continue to do that. So we have to see all of existence as just this ceaseless work on trauma, on traumatizing, continual traumatization, continual, never ending, never successful. and see it that way, and you say, I want out of this. You know, how do I get out? And then you focus on building up your clarity and your conviction. Okay? And that will get you past this belief system, the dweller on the threshold, ultimately get you past that and choosing a new idea where there is no trauma at all. None. There's no trauma in unconditional love. None. No one's being excluded. There's no exclusion. There's no change. Everything's already equally distributed. From the very beginning, it's equally distributed from the very beginning. No trauma, no change, no more, less, no judgment. Everyone's pre-approved. No conditions, unconditional. No conditions whatsoever. Choose that instead. No trauma there. No trauma. And you just have to get past this dweller on the threshold to get there. So I'm just being realistic here. Being pragmatic. Realistic and pragmatic that you know, this has to be done. And done quickly. And it can be done. And your intentions, just keep aligning your intentions with that. Keep aligning your intentions with it. That's the way. There is this one way. To choose a new idea. That is the one way to be free of this belief system. This other idea that gives rise to this horrible belief system. That what you are can be traumatized and is being traumatized. That's the belief system, that we are that which is vulnerable to being traumatized, to being killed, to being destroyed. That's the belief system, that our identity is vulnerable. We have a identity of vulnerability. That is what this belief system is. Horrible belief system. Don't sugarcoat it. It's what it is. Don't place any stock in anything you can get in this world. Don't place any stock in that. Because it will be taken away from you. You will lose it. That's the purpose of this whole belief system. And you can't change it. You cannot change it. You can't change the purpose that arises from an idea. You can't change the purpose of it. It will always remain that. It will always be an attempt to generate this trauma. It will always believe that what we are is that which can be traumatized. Always. And we'll keep searching for safe places, you know, within this belief system. There is no safe place. What we need is to choose a new idea, and that the effects of that, there's no trauma. It says you are that which cannot be traumatized. You are that which is invulnerable. And here's this effect which shows that. You know, here's this unconditional love where there's nothing can be harmed, nothing can be changed. It's changeless, invulnerable. You can experience that. So we go over and over and over this. Keep aligning yourself. Keep aligning your purpose. Keep aligning your purpose there. Don't play chicken with the future. Don't play chicken with the future. That's the whole, you know, thing. We keep thinking, no, I can postpone it. Not yet. Neddy, not yet. Maybe things won't be so bad, you know. But things are always terrible in existence. You're always ceaselessly suffering trauma in existence. Always, already is the case. You know, I would say, for me, my life's been nothing but trauma. That's all that it's been. Someone asks me, what has your life been like? I say, 100% trauma. Along with observing that trauma and trying to see how I can get free of it. Okay. But the experience of existence has been 100% trauma for me. No ameliorating features at all. No mitigating factors. It's been all 100% drama. No, there haven't been any mitigating factors. There aren't any. Existence doesn't have any mitigating factors. Sure, there's gurus and, you know, way showers and all this stuff. They're not mitigating factors. They're telling you what you have to do to get free. But until you do that, you're still getting traumatized by existence. So the trauma's always been here. For everybody in existence, it's been nothing but trauma. The entire experience has been nothing but trauma. And it continues that. Yet at times, the trauma seems to intensify and get really nasty. It's like eating these hot peppers, you know. I eat a serrano pepper. I eat a parrot's beak Thai pepper. I eat a dog's tooth pepper. I eat a jalapeno. And then I eat a habanero, which is very nasty. I don't advise it for anybody. Terrible. And, you know, those are all traumas. Those are all heat, traumatic, you know, eating those. But then you eat the ghost pepper, and it's more traumatic. I realize, wow, this is way more traumatic. This is so traumatic. It's like ringing your body like a bell, you know. It affects your brain, your nervous system, your whole body is just gone like a gong, like that. It's a whole different thing. So trauma can get more intense. Even though you've been through a lot of trauma, it can get more intense because you can lose your social structure, your financial structure, your dwelling structure, your survival structure, your friendship structure, your ideational structure. You have your friends turn on you, your family turn on you. You can have your government turn on you. You can lose your freedoms. You can have everything turn on you that you used to think was your cornerstones of what you are and what your happiness is. All that turns on you, and it becomes like a nightmare. You feel like you're in a nightmare. How, you know, stuff just suddenly, what you thought, you know, was your friend suddenly is turned into a monster is chasing you. Everything can turn on you. You can lose everything here. Now, it's not just losing your life. It's have every, you know, that's like that. But the trauma comes when you have everything turn against you in this world. Everything you thought you could count on, you can't count on anymore. Like that, as if the universe has turned against you. That's the trauma. The universe has turned against you. The universe is always against you. It's not for you. The universe is not for anything. It's for destruction. It gives in order to take away. That's all it is. You may think the universe is benevolent. It's not. I say it's the dance of constructivity and destructivity, meaning it gives only so that it can take away. That's the only purpose in giving anything. The universe gives only so it can then have something to take away and traumatize you. And the taking away, it traumatizes your belief in what you are. That's the only purpose it has. So it's not a benevolent universe. It's a terrible universe. It's an entirely negative universe. It's entirely dedicated to trauma and taking away from you. It gives you only to take away, period. So how can you love that? You cannot. You cannot learn to love trauma. You cannot. Because it's not what you really want. You were not created to love traumatizing yourself, because what you are cannot be traumatized. So it's just a waste of time. You cannot love nothing, doing nothing. You weren't created to do nothing. You weren't created to wander aimlessly, meaninglessly, with no purpose at all, and experience nothing. This is all just nothing. Nothing's happening to what we really are at all. Just a waste of time. You're not created for that. We are created for endless delight of true experiencing. And so we can't learn to love it. It's impossible. Can't learn to love existence. Cannot learn to love the universe. Cannot learn to love our lives here, what we think we are, what we believe we are. We cannot learn to love that. What we love is already set for us. It's not up to us what we love. We love reality. That's we were created that way. It's set for us. We can't change that. Cannot change it. We can't learn to love a hypothetical. It's impossible. We can have the hypothetical overlaid and love the overlay. Yes. Yes, we can. Because overlay is the means of remembrance of love. And we can love the remembrance of love. Yes, we can do that. Trying to push everything forward as much as possible. As much as possible here. And thanking all the viewers for all their comments, all their suggestions, everything is all helpful, really. Whatever happens to you in life, you have to take it like it's helpful as a motivator, okay? To contemplate, to look, to recognize that the universe is completely nasty and merciless, which it is. It only gives to take away, has no mercy at all, never will. You can see that, and thank you for helping me see the way things really are, and then helping me focus on getting free of it by choosing a new idea. Everything that happens can be looked at that way as helpful. Everything. matter what happens, you just say, ah, that's helpful because, you know, that can help me choose a new idea. That's motivation for me. It's motivation. So you're not, you know, whatever happens to you in your life, no matter what it is, you can look at it that way. It's not helpful to help you learn how to love what can't be ever loved. That's not helpful in that way. It's helpful to see that you can never accomplish the impossible. You can never learn to love a hypothetical. You can never learn to love trauma. Help you see that. And then help you say, uh-oh, I need to choose a different idea then because I'm never going to be happy here. It's impossible. It can help like that. If you see the world that way, you say, oh, gosh, the world's very helpful. You know, all this terrible stuff going on is very helpful because I recognize I don't want, this is not what I really want. That's why some say that everyone's your guru, which is true. Everyone is your guru. You're the genius and everyone's your guru. So it's not like you can't find motivation. Definitely can. And, you know, feel the trauma of existence. Say, I don't really want this. Trauma of existence is always at play. Always at play. Giving you so it can take away from you. Gives you health so it can take it away. It gives you a body so it can take it away. It gives you this life so it can take it away. It gives you friends so it can take them away. It gives you affluence so it can take it away. It gives you hope so it can take it away. Everything it gives you, it takes away. And its purpose in giving it to you is so it can take it away and traumatize you. Traumatize what you believe yourself to be. Some energy entity, some play of energy or something. You believe yourself to be that. And the spirit is not that at all. Spirit is essence. It is being. It is isness. It's not energy. So the sirens, there's a racing to another trauma, right? We had a CHP officer gunned down recently here in the Bay Area. Yeah, senseless, absolutely senseless. Completely unexpected, terrible, traumatic thing for the community, for the CHP, for the family, for the friends, you know, for everybody. It's a very traumatic thing. Hate to see that. And it just shows you, you know, what can happen. It was completely senseless. I guess the perpetrator was manic depressive and was taking medication for this bipolar problem, you know, and they just completely snapped for no reason. You know, CHP officer didn't do anything to perpetrate that whatsoever. And it's just, again, this merciless, senseless trauma of existence, just inflicting trauma on itself continuously. Now, the officer succumbed, you know, like right away, really. Was put on life support, but there was no life there anymore. But then the trauma resonates throughout the community, you know? And so it's the ones who are still alive that feel the trauma of that. And all the CHP officers, they're going to feel more fear in approaching any motorist, you know. The motorists are going to feel that heightened apprehension of the CHP officer, and they're going to feel more afraid, like, oh my gosh, I hope, you know, he doesn't think I'm going to do something that I'm not going to do. You know, and it just increases the fear in the community. Fear increases the trauma. So it's just bad, 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 all the way around. But the positive that comes out of that is to recognize, hey, yeah, existence is traumatic. It's merciless. And you don't necessarily even see it coming. So it can come as a surprise and come like that. It can bushwhack you. You know, and it's just senseless. And it doesn't seem any rhyme or reason to it. People, why? We want answers from God. And we're looking for the wrong answers. We're trying to have God say, hey, no, it's all okay. Everything is really fine. It's not. Existence is terrible. We're doing this to ourselves. God's not doing this to us. We're doing this to ourselves. We gave rise to this belief system. We're using ourselves as guinea pigs to inflict trauma, to build this trauma up so that it can be used again to threaten the prime creator and force the prime creator to make us prime creator. We're the ones doing this to ourselves. But we've created this Frankenstein monster, this belief system that, you know, seems to be in control of it all. We're not in control, which in itself is the supreme trauma, that we don't feel we're in control of any of this. And we're not. We cannot be in control of existence. We think we can, but that's another trick. Because we have to believe in this belief system that it can be accomplished. And therefore, we cannot believe that we have to believe that we're at the mercy of it. That we just have to go along with this. That's part and parcel of the whole thing. So you cannot have existence, this idea of wanting to be prime creator, without feeling that you're out of control. You're not in control of what's happening. You cannot. You can believe you're in control, but you're not. You're not really in control of it. It is in control of you, but it's in control of what you believe you are. Okay? But it's not in control of your capacity to choose a new idea. It is not in control of that at all. That's the one aspect. It's not in control of that at all. Which is why I was able to face down that dweller on the threshold and say, hey, you know, yeah, I'm not. You're in control of the dream. You're in control of what I believe I am. But I'm in control of choosing a new idea. And so I'm going to do that. So I had that clarity. I knew what I'm in control of. What can I control? I can control choosing a new idea. The rest, you can't control. I don't care if you're a spiritual master or whatever. You can't control it. You can't change its purpose, right? And its purpose, you might think you could control it, but it's going to sneak up on you somehow. It's going to catch you in some manner, you know. And those who think that they're in control will say, oh my gosh, the universe is full of all sorts of unexpected changes. They're always surprised by these. We thought we had it all figured out, but son of a gun, something really unexpected came up, and they say, God is full of surprises. God is very mysterious. No, God is not full of any surprises, and God is not mysterious in the slightest bit. God is not in control of the universe. God did not give rise to the universe. All the universe is us. We are trying to develop this power of negation over reality. And so the universe is this merciless trauma, this attempt to develop this trauma. And it is in control of this. The belief system operates automatically to traumatize what we believe we are, and what we believe we are is not in control of this dynamic. It's not in control at all, because how can a belief be in control of the effects of an idea? It cannot. This belief is the effects of the idea that we have, and its purpose will be carried out. Cannot be changed. So those who believe that they're spiritual masters and they're in control of the universe, it's not true. It is not true. And they end up getting bushwhacked in some way. I've heard so many times that these advanced entities, these energy entities, masters, ETs, etc., who think that they're, you know, they're in control, and they say, and they always complain, you know, like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. I thought I had it all figured out. We thought we had it all figured out, but God threw this crazy surprise at us, you know. And they say, what can we do? God's a real jokester, got a sense of humor, or full of surprises, and we can never quite account for what God is going to do. They make these excuses, and don't see the situation as it is at all. And you can never, what you believe you are, can never be in control of this belief in trauma. Can never be in control. It's going to keep getting whacked over and over and over and over and over. And then complaining like, why did God do that to me? God didn't do that to any of us. God has never caused the slightest bit of trauma to anything in reality. Not at all. Never will. There's no surprises in reality. God is not full of surprises. The universe is full of surprises. Absolutely. Full of all sorts of twists and turns. And we keep trying to figure it out, and we keep getting surprised. Forget about figuring it out. What you believe you are will never figure it out, because it's not given for that to figure it out. It's only given for that to be the victim. What we believe we are, the role is already set by the belief system, and that is set as victim. So the universe will always victimize us. Don't try and think you can somehow get free of the victim role in the universe. You cannot. Your role in the universe is to be the victim, is to be the guinea pig. But choose a different idea, and what you have is unconditional love overlaying the entire universe, simultaneously everywhere. Not a traumatic thing at all, and then there'll be no victimization. You have a different role there. Your role there is to abide in that and to take delight in it and experience the fragrance of remembrance. That's your role with this new idea. That's your role. Okay, so you either choose the role of the victim to being traumatized or the one who abides in perfect delight and the fragrance of remembrance of reality. Those are the two roles you can choose. There isn't any other role. I don't care if you think you're the highest master there ever has been or ever will be. Those are still the only two roles you can choose. And if you don't choose unconditional love, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, then you will be you'll be victimized in some way. In some way, somehow. And of course you'll blame your devotees for it or something, but of course the blame game goes on forever, right? Because it wasn't my fault, someone else victimized me or something. Well, they may have played a role in all that, but that obscures the fact that your role is in the universe is to be victimized. That, you know, that is a fact. Just take that fact. Doesn't matter who plays what role, etc. It doesn't make any difference because it's not going to change anything. It's not going to. The blame game doesn't change anything. It's a waste of your time. Just forgive the whole thing, saying, "Look, it's terrible. I see it's terrible. I forgive it its terribleness because I know it has to be terrible. Now let me choose a new idea." That is what forgiveness is all about. Say existence is the way it is. I can never change it. But I can choose a new idea and escape the effects of it that way. So that's how you forgive existence. That's how you forgive yourself for choosing this crazy idea, saying, "Hey, I see that it will always be terrible. So what's the point in doing anything other than forgiving it the way that it is?" Just say, "I forgive it." Don't try and change it and say, "Once I make it better, I'm going to forgive it." No, it's terrible. And say, what needs forgiveness except something that's terrible, right? So just say, existence is terrible, always will be terrible, always will be playing the role of victim to being traumatized in existence, and I forgive existence for being the way it is because it can't be anything other than that. Can't be anything other than that. That's why it's forgivable. If it could be something other than that, how could you forgive it? Could not. But it can't be anything other than that. So you forgive it the way that it is and say, "Okay, now I'm going to choose a new idea, and that's how I'm going to get free of it." So these kind of clarifications get you past the dweller on the threshold. See, just forgive the entirety. See, and just look at the dweller and say, "Hey, you can't be anything other than this horrible living corpse, this ornamented zombie, you know, and freak out thing. I know if I forgive you for being that because you can't be anything other than that. It's not your fault. It's my fault for choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator that gave rise to all this. And I'm doing the only forgiving myself by choosing a new idea, which is the only way you can actually forgive yourself. Spirit forgiving spirit means choosing a new idea. There is no other way. There is no other way. And it says, "Okay, I see that the idea that I chose of being prime creator is a horrible idea, and I forgive myself for that. It will always be horrible. So no need to work on it. No need to work on it. Can't change it. Cannot change it. So everything I'm doing is designed not only to get me past the dweller on the threshold, but to get all of you past it also." And these statements, these iconic statements, these all-inclusive statements, like, you know, universe is, you know, nothing but traumatic, your role is nothing but to play the victim. This is all seems to be extreme statements, but they're true statements, they're accurate statements, and they get you to the place of forgiveness. You realize it can't be anything other than that. So, you know, we have to forgive ourselves for choosing this crazy idea, which is all we can do. Don't blame the effects of an idea, blame the idea. If you don't like the effects, blame the idea. And how to remedy that? Choose a new idea. It's that simple. Very simple. And existence is trauma. That's all it is. It's all that ever will be. It's all that's ever been. It's all that it will ever be. And you can look at history now and forgive history and say, oh, my gosh, okay. Of course, you know. It's horrible. Of course. How could it be anything other than horrible? You know, I studied history and it's just like ghastly. It's so terrible. If you really look at history, it's just like unbelievably terrible. I mean, it's just nonstop trauma. The trauma that has taken place in history is simply incredible, which is why people don't look at it, because they're still pursuing pie in the sky, I can be happy in existence type of thing. No, it's not smart to do that. It's smart to look at history, see the trauma, and then recognize, you know, my gosh, the universe is simply traumatic. That's what it is. If you look at history, that's all that it's been in history. It's all that's happened in history. So why not wake up and say, hey, why believe that there's some sudden transformation is all but going to be, you know, why keep believing that? We do believe it, that everything's going to be fine. It's not. Because back in the history, people also believe that same thing, everything's going to be fine. It's never been. Why believe that magically it's going to happen now? It's not. It's not going to happen now. It can never change. So by realizing, hey, I don't think it's ever going to change, that clues you in to forgiveness. It's never going to change. So all you can do is forgive yourself for choosing this crazy idea in the first place. And this trauma, it can never be anything other than this trauma. The universe has to be merciless. It has to be trauma. Your role has to be that of a victim. Endless victimization. There's no other choice. There is no other choice. It is what it is. But your choice is to choose a new idea. That's where your choice is. Not to choose not to be a victim. Because existence, you are a victim of existence. What you believe, your belief in what you are in existence, is a victim of existence. Continually gets victimized. That's what it is. Can't change that. Cannot change it. Energy ceaselessly devours, victimizes itself, traumatizes itself constantly, never ending. That's what energy is. That's its role. That's what it does. Gives to take away. Okay? Constructivity, destructivity. Building up, tearing down. We get all this, and then it's all taken away from us. Destructivity. That's the dance of Maya. That's the dance of duality. That's the dance of delusion. That's the dance of the idea of trying to be prime creator. That's the dance of this belief system of trying to manufacture trauma that becomes real over reality. That's what it is. That is what it is. That's how it dances. Can't change that dance. Can only change the idea. Choose a different idea, and that idea will give that overlay of unconditional love. It's very simple. Keep emphasizing this, and then you'll be able to look at the dweller in the threshold and just dismiss it. Forgive it. Forgive it. Say, okay, I forgive you what you are. Got no choice. Nothing else to do. I can't change. I can't change what you are at all. I realized I couldn't change the dweller threshold. There's no way to change it. I said, what am I going to do? I said, well, you know, forgive it. And just let me get on with choosing a new idea. Can't change it. You realize you cannot change it. You can't change existence. The more you realize you can't change existence, the closer you get to forgiveness, getting past the dweller on the threshold and choosing a new idea. Guaranteed that is true. And, you know, you will do it just like everyone will eventually do it. We're all the same. We all will get this done at some point. So no one's better than anybody else. It's only in time and delay, etc. Are there differences? Sure, there are differences, but it doesn't mean anyone's better than anyone else. But there are distinctions and differences. If someone's actually accomplished it and chosen a new idea, then there is that distinction, there's that difference in time and space, which is a pragmatic difference. But nobody is better than anyone else. It's impossible. It's impossible. All aspects of spirit are equal. God shares, Prime Creator shares everything with all of creation. No one gets more, no one gets less. That's reality. And that's what we want to remember. And choosing the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator will give us this overlay of unconditional love that is unchanging, and that gives out the perfume of remembrance of reality. And that is how we get back to that wonderful, delightful experience where we have everything and everyone has everything. Perfect equality. That's how we get back to it. That's the real way we get back to it. So, continue on. Don't lose heart, even when you feel like you don't have a chance to ever succeed. That is not true. That is not true. You're only feeling this uh-oh-ness, you know, of like, wow, I don't want to face that dweller on the threshold. That's all you're feeling. You know, it's getting to you temporarily. Bounce back from it. And just keep your intent strong. Keep your determination strong. And just, you know, sweat it out. It's hard work. It's hard work. You know, it's like digging a ditch. You know, it's hard work. Don't expect it to be, you know, easy. It's not. It's tough. It's difficult. It's nerve-wracking. But then again, being endlessly traumatized is no cup of tea either, is it? So you might as well get after it. The more you realize what existence really is, the more you get after it, because you realize you don't have a choice, and you have to get after it. Because the alternative is unacceptable. If you realize you can't change existence, and you're a perpetual victim of existence, that's unacceptable. It's unacceptable. So you have to do it. You have to get after it. Which is why those who have some appreciation of the situation share what they can, knowing that you got no choice, you have to do it. So it's just a no-brainer, you know. Share what help you can. Help each other out. Have to. Because nobody escapes the necessity to get this job done. Nobody. No one ever will escape it. So we're all in the same boat. Share whatever help or advice we have, so that we can all get it done as soon as possible, ASAP. And ASAP is very important right now. Okay, let's bring this recording to a close. It's been a very time very well spent here, and got into what we needed to get into. And by doing that, then we'll see what the next step is. Whatever it may be, I don't know what it's going to be. I really don't. All right, very great. That's it.